I'd like to first of all thank Neil and the restorative justice people so for inviting us here and sponsoring us, and I just very much appreciate that. Thank you so much. Okay, I'll use this one. All right. Oh, did you turn that off? Okay. And so thank you, the restorative justice people. Thank you all for sponsoring us here and making this possible. And we'd also like to thank Wes and the Silverside Museum also for hosting this event. And thank you so much for providing us with this opportunity to be here. We're going to do tonight is talk about something very unusual. But before we get into that, I just want to express our appreciation and sincere gratitude for all of the veterans who have served this nation, past and current, who've gone to war and worked. Thank you so much for your service. We work constantly with the veterans. We are contacted by them constantly. And just what a great, great group of guys. But thank you all of you veterans in all the wars. Thank you so much. What I was going to do tonight is give you a little presentation about what it is that we do and why, and kind of explain that and discuss maybe the possible future goals of this. But it just so happened that a couple weeks ago we received a letter from this guy. This is a picture of him during World War II. His name is Arno, and he lives in South Dakota. And he wrote us this letter, 3 pages handwritten, and it just so happens that his letter happened to explain what it is that we do better than I could put into words. So we'll just look at Arno's letter here and see what he says. And I'm not going to scare you here, but here's how his letter began to us. Handwritten on this college rule, he says, Obon Society, Post Office Box 282, Astoria, Oregon 97103. And then his first sentence is this: I have been informed of the work you do returning World War II items to Japan. And then his second paragraph: I was with the 6th Marine Division during the Battle of Okinawa. I was not interested in bringing home items from battle and never once went through the pockets of the dead. And then he goes on with his story. During the very last days of the battle for the island, I had a young replacement with me in my foxhole. I'll continue with his letter. It was his very first night in a foxhole. Now this is Arno here. It's not the. It was a partial moonlight night. During my watch, a Jap came within 25 feet from my foxhole. I shot. And my young man was all excited and wanted to check it out. I pulled him back. You don't leave your foxhole at night. He had a lot to learn. At first daylight, he went out to check things out and came back with a small coin purse, and there was a family photo, folded and well worn. I did not want any of it, but he thought he had done me a favor. So these ended up in my backpack. Summer of 1946, I was home. After some time, I cleaned out my sea bag and found those 2 items that I had forgotten about. Even then, I wanted to throw this away, but I had put a Marine album together and laid the photo of this family in the back pages of the album where it laid for many years, forgotten. And then his next paragraph. After my retirement, having more time to think, I kept thinking of this photo and the family. There are 10 in this picture, the same as my family. And when I looked at our family photo, I kept thinking more and more about this photo I had for so long. About 15 years ago, a friend of mine who is an author and travels worldwide ran this picture in a Japan paper, also in Okinawa. There was no response. And then Arno says, if I could have located the family 15 years ago, I would have taken a flight to hand it to them. Being I am over 90 now, this would not be possible. I question if this family can be located, but it would be great if I could put this to rest before I am laid to rest. Arno, Spearfish, South Dakota. And so here is really what we're talking about, and it's who contacts us, they and their families. It is these veterans who, just as he described, he was in battle, it was war, they gathered souvenirs and brought them back, it was a time of victory, and then those years go by and the feelings change. And then, as in Arno's case, there is this desire to reach out to that other family, and knowing that that guy did not come home to connect with that family. And that's who and what we do. We are the point of contact between these veterans and their families and the families in Japan. And we get contacted every day, numerous times, America, Canada, England, Wales, Scotland, Ireland, New Zealand, Australia, all over the place, with people who have these souvenirs, who have the same exact feeling that Arno is expressing. This is about a photograph, and we get people brought home a wide variety of things, but more commonly, they brought back something that we see on display over there, and Keiko is going to show you as I start reading these letters here. Here's a letter from a man named Peter. Dear sir or madam, please find attached photos of a World War II good luck flag that was taken from a dead Japanese lieutenant officer by my father. My father is now 92 years of age and in a nursing home. It is his wish that the flag be returned to the Japanese officer's family. The flag was carried by a lieutenant officer who died in September 1943 on the south bank of the Betio River near Dot Inlet, New Guinea. His name could be among the many written on the flag, and if possible, I would like the flag to be given to his next of kin. The reason for this request is my family knows the heartache of losing a loved one. My uncle, Donald Thompson, fell at Kodoka, New Guinea, and his body was never recovered. Yours faithfully, Peter. Another letter. And there are just many. My family has a flag my grandfather brought back from World War II. My grandfather and the soldier fought very close combat, and my grandfather had to take the man's life. He was haunted by this experience for the rest of his life, and I would like to look into returning it to the family to hopefully get some closure for the man's family and to make some healing for my grandfather in the afterlife. Cameron Fisher. Another letter. I am interested in giving my flags back to the families of the Japanese soldiers that my uncles killed in action in the Pacific Theater of War in 1944 and 1945. It is because of the suffering that my grandmother went through in having two boys killed in the war that motivates me to return these bloodstained flags to their families in Japan so perhaps they might receive some solace. And so these letters just go on and on and on that we receive, and it's just this aspect of war or the aftermath of war that we had no idea existed. My father-in-law, a United States Marine rifleman, received what he described as a prayer flag from a fallen Japanese soldier on Tarawa Atoll on 24th of November, 1943. The old Marine passed away last week, but not before advising us that, if possible, efforts be made to return the flag to any descendants of the soldier. We wish that it be returned to the people of Japan in honor of one of their fallen, Neil Robiax, Abbeville, Louisiana. Another letter. In terms of my grandfather's Yosagaki Hinomaru in my possession, this is the last item that my grandfather gave me, so it is difficult to part with it. I know he killed Japanese soldiers. I also know he had respect for them. He told me, sometimes it was just luck, and he understood that we are all people. It hurt him for the rest of his life. He was not proud about that. He lived out his life on antidepressants and would hardly ever talk about it. I believe that this is why I have the flag, but I cannot part with it easily. I would love the chance to personally hand the flag back to the family. I know there was a reason I was entrusted with this. And so these letters are like this, the communications coming, and there's just so many of them that this is just what we do. These were taken back from battle. What you see on here, we should be changing places here, but what you would have on a flag like this that would be just a blank flag when the family purchased it is they would then write, the mother or the father or some friend would write the soldier's name on it, a message of good luck in battle and strong, and then they sign their names to it, to generally. On some of them, the mothers will dip their hand in ink and leave a handprint there and then write mother by it. If the soldier had little children that could not sign, sometimes there we see these little children's handprints there. And what this almost looks like, if you can imagine it, would be like the inside of a yearbook cover, if you could read what's written there, where people look at his graduating senior, sign their names, and they say, good luck to you, and hey, you were quite a guy, and take care of yourself, and hey, Joey this, and Bob that. That's basically what this appears like on these, if you could interpret it and read it. It's some people have described this as like a love letter to the person going away, that this is the family going with him in spirit to war. And so this is what it is. They carried these for the American soldiers. This was the most perfect souvenir you could imagine. Once they discovered that underneath people's clothing or inside their helmet, they could find a Japanese flag, it was ideal. You could carry it easily, just shove it in one of your socks in your pack and bring it home. It's not bulky, and it was just the ideal souvenir to bring back. And better yet, it's a Japanese flag, and every soldier had one or two or three. You see, the family would give each soldier one, and then if that soldier also was, let's say, a ticket taker on a train, well, then the train company, the locomotive company, the train stations, they might produce one for him, and they would all write their names. Or we just received one. He was probably a sound man or a lighting man on a Hollywood set, and they were making a Hollywood movie in Japan. All of the actors and actresses and everybody signed their names onto it. And so it's like wherever he was, whatever he was doing, the people around him as he was drafted and going to war would all sign their names. And if he was also a student at the university, same thing. Professors, classmates, other people would sign their names. So soldiers would go to war with one, two, or three of these typically under their clothing. And so this is what the soldiers have here, the veterans. Their fathers brought home or they have. And in many cases, what we discover, what people tell us is, they're the children of the soldiers. Mom, dad died some years ago. Mom has to go to a retirement community. They have to make all those adjustments. The kids go in to clean out the house. And here is a box in the closet or up in the attic or someplace that they didn't know. And they bring it down and here's all these things from the war. And they start to go through it and they discover these and something they had no idea even existed. And they're almost shocked by the sight of this. And then they wanted, their first thought is, for many of them that contact us is, can you get this back to the family? It means something to somebody. And so that is just simply what we do. We are the receiving end of the desires and wishes of these veterans and these families who have these items. Now, logically, the question is, okay, so what is it like on the other side of the ocean when you find these families and return it to them or make contact with them? What happens on that? And this is the part of our world that just shows that how as different and separate as we can be living in different nations or different cultures, how in fact we are so very similar with each other about many, many things, especially the intimate things such as family. And so here, for example, is a story. Here's a Japanese soldier with his wife, his photo, and you can see across his chest here, he has two flags here tied across his chest. You can see the red center and some of the writing on this grainy photograph. And there he's leaving home, leaving his wife. And then several months later, here's another picture of him. And he's now with the family group. He's in his Navy outfit here. And he's holding in his arms there a little white bundle in this lousy photograph. And you zoom in on that photograph, and he's actually holding his one-month-old child. And this is the first time the child was born, and the mother went to the base there, and here it is, and this is his first time that he sees his child, and then she goes back home, he ships out, and he was sunk 6 months later.
He went to Saipan.
Oh, Saipan. He was killed.
6 months later, after photo was taken, and he was dying in Saipan, July 8th, and disappeared.
So the mother, she raised him, and he became a young man and grew up after the war in Japan. And then somehow, some American, I can't remember their name, got one of those flags and kept it for all these years that had been tied around him, contacted us and asked us, can you get that back to the family? And so just like this, we do this search where we start tracking these names down. We have scholars that do this. And sure enough, of all things, we found that little baby 70 years later. And here he is in a Shinto shrine with a priest and his wife, and they are receiving this through a ceremony because many of these that we return are returned, the family's request, a Shinto ceremony. Welcoming the spirit back. And so here he is. Now here he is, you can see he's wearing gloves respectfully, looking for the first time at this remnant of this father he never knew. He told us in a letter when he wrote us that this flag was the first time he ever felt the touch of his father in his life. And so it was
he's the one sent this photo to us, including his handwritten thank you letter. And then this is right before his 70th birthday. And then he will never imagine that the father's flag come back to see him. He never felt his father close to him, his life, because that's something he doesn't know. And then when he received his father's flag, he wrote a letter, said, "This is the first time I have felt father very close to me." And it made me cry.
And so here he is outside of the shrine, having gone through this ceremony of receiving this. And now this is the son of a soldier who receives it. And just coincidentally, we happen to be in Japan at a time when such a ceremony was going on, and we were invited to it. And so I shot a little video here. It just takes 2 minutes, and it's going to take you inside of a shrine, something that very few foreigners have ever seen. In fact, very few Americans have even seen it. And so we'll just take a quick look at this little ceremony. The people are shocked and surprised that the Americans return these and the feelings, and it's just this remarkable, just this international kind of goodwill, that the fact that the Americans, after all these years, have this desire to return this back to their families. It's spreading out in Japan. They thought, well, you know, that nobody cared, and it was all forgotten, and it just is this overwhelming experience for the Japanese at many different levels. Another example. This is quite a remarkable story. Mr. Watanabe. This man had two older brothers. He never served in the war, had two older brothers. One was sent to China. He died, and his fellow soldiers returned his remains to his mother. And then he had a younger brother who was sent to Okinawa and disappeared without a trace. And so this is the missing brother. That's all they have of him. And as Mr. Watanabe told us, that for years and years, you know, the Japanese soldiers, because they were held in Russia and different places, they did not return in 1 or 2 years. They actually returned over the course of 10 years to Japan after the war, till 1955 and 56, they were still coming back. And so every time a ship would come in to the port, his mother would go down there and watch the offloading soldiers looking for her son, because there was no word of him. And the years went by, and she kept waiting for her son to come back that was missing, and he never returned. And as she got older and older, she told him, "Try to find your brother." And then she passed away. And so he did the scholarly work that somebody like Wes would do. He got out books and he looked at which group was his brother with? Who was he fighting with? What division or company? And where were they stationed in Okinawa? On what ridge or what coastline or on what valley? Where were they? And he spent years researching like the last steps of where he knew his brother was last seen. And then he joined a bone recovery volunteer group. Because you see, in Japan today, there are still over 1,140,000 Japanese soldiers who are just missing, just gone. And so the people have been actively trying to recover them, and they go out in these groups and volunteer to the old battlefields looking for the remains of the fallen soldiers, and they pile them up and they cremate them. They do it very respectfully, and then they bring the ashes back to Japan. And this has been going on for quite a while. And so Mr. Watanabe volunteered for one of these groups to do this. And he went digging for his brother on this battlefield. And he didn't just dig for 1 year or 2 years or 3 years or 10 years, but he went back each summer digging, looking for his brother for 30 years and couldn't find his brother. And then he developed cancer. And so here he is, his mother's gone, he's at the end of his life, and we happen to receive this flag. And our scholars did the searching, and we tracked it back to him, we thought. And so we sent him some digital files and said, is this possibly your brother? Not knowing any of the searching that he'd been doing. And so he took these digital files and he blew them up on large paper and put it together. And he looked at it and he said, that's my brother I've been looking for. He says, send me the flag. I'm still in chemotherapy. Send me the flag. And as soon as I'm recovered, I'll go down to the battlefield and with the flag where my brother died, and I'll have a picture taken and sent it to you. And so Keiko translates his letter to me, and I'm thinking, well, he's got cancer. He lives in northern Japan, where you see those monkeys in the hot springs in the snow, and this is Okinawa. It's a long ways. He's got cancer. But here, like several months later, comes his photograph, respectfully dressed up in a suit, with a monument where the division died or whatever, with his brother's flag. He then hired a priest to come in to do a ceremony that night to pray over his brother's spirit there and welcome him home. And then he went back to Hokkaido, and he went to the cemetery where his mother's grave was, and he showed her that the brother came back and he had him. And so this is a brother-to-brother relationship that we often deal with in this case also. And so finally he was able to accomplish his mother's wish of reuniting the family. And it just so happens we have a little video here again of a brother receiving his brother's remains that we happen to have witnessed.
うん、使う。そうです。<笑> よく帰ってきたね。お盆に今以上のおかげですよ。
ありがとうございました。
This is 7 years older than him. When he separated his older brother, he was 17 years old. He remembers the last moment he and his brother went to the photo studio, took the photo together. That's the last memory. He remembers him very well, and then he doesn't know how he died, what happened, nothing came back. So this is the very first moment when we find his brother's flag. By the time when he received, it's no longer his flag, it is himself. So he said, you finally come home. It's just brother coming back to see him. So that's what you see. Just luckily, Rex and I had to present it. By the time we happened to be in Japan, he requested that this is another Shinto shrine where we had the similar ceremony. And after that, and he met his brother. So they treat like not the flag. He's talking to the flag as his brother alive and coming back to see him. So that is the other side of the world, when the time when this find a way home.
So that's just basically, really, in a nutshell. I mean, there's nothing really more to say. We're not political. We're not religious. We're not we don't have any agenda or anything. We are just merely this point of contact, as I've described to people. Where it's sort of like an hourglass. The upper hourglass are these souvenirs in the possession of many people. And some want to return it, and then it comes down to this little narrow constriction where all the sand has to pass through, and it comes to us, and then we try to find the families over there. We do not ask the people to send these to us. We don't request it. We don't advertise. It's just people like this veteran here, and the sister of that soldier there, who she was the last remaining member of her family. And this brother disappeared when he was 15, and her plans are that when she dies, he will go in the funeral and in the casket with her, and she'll be buried with her brother. That's all that's left of her family. Again, here just more veterans that contact us, and or their families of veterans with these souvenirs they want us to handle, and then family here, children of a Japanese soldier. And again, a brother of a Japanese soldier there. You can see his ancestors up above on the wall, and here another American veteran here. And it's just, here's a family here. We returned the flag, and they sent us this picture. You can see they're all gathered with their portraits. The family's all back together again. And it's just as simple as this. There's nothing special about this. We could go on and talk, but CBS actually came and heard about this, and they filmed us, or they didn't film much of us, but there was a story. They asked us, they said, do you know any Americans who have returned flags to where we've connected? And we said, well, yeah, we have like, you know, almost 100 of them. Which ones do you want? So we put them in touch with a young man in Las Vegas, in that area. And so his story unfolds here.
Opposing sides in war share little, other than perhaps a battlefield and the longing to go home. Glenn Stockdale of Billings, Montana, did come home. He fought the Japanese in the Pacific until 1945. As a young staff sergeant, he saw things most of us can't even imagine. And until the day he died, at age 84, kept most of it to himself.
Never talked about the war.
It just sort of, he just locked it all away?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. That's Glenn's son, Terry. What he knew of his dad's service came mostly from rummaging through his father's old footlocker.
It was in the basement, so as kids, you go down looking and see what's in here, what's in there.
Among other things, Terry found a Japanese flag, carefully folded, stained with blood and covered in writing. Then he found another, and another.
They were memories of the war, a trophy, you know, spoils of war.
Collecting them was commonplace. Pictures abound of U.S. servicemen posing with the flags. Known as a Yosagaki Hinamaru, Japanese soldiers carried them as keepsakes into battle, good luck charms of sorts, with wishes from family and friends scrawled around the rising sun. Keepsakes in battle. But in Glenn Stockdale's footlocker, the flags had become just ghosts of a long-ago enemy. And nearing the end of his father's life, Terry suggested it was time. The flags go home.
What did you say to him?
I thought it'd be nice to send it back to Japan.
And when?
He said no.
Because?
Must be the hate from fighting people and just war. I don't know what that does to individuals. I've never been there.
So that's where things and the flags sat for more than a decade, until Terry heard another World War II vet speak of the flags. His name was Leland Bud Lewis. Bud was in the same infantry division as Terry's father, the 41st. They never met. Bud was behind the front lines, sending the bombs and the bullets up, something that at age 95, Bud still doesn't take lightly.
I provided all the ammunition that killed all these folks. And I'm not exactly totally happy that I did that. But at the time, that was my job. I couldn't question that.
Why now? Why is it important, you think, to return the flags now?
Well, it's a closure. You can't keep hating people.
Inspired, Terry Stockdale packed up one of his father's flags and mailed it to the only place he thought could help, a home in a small town along the Columbia River in Washington, where the flags are celebrated with a ceremony.
This is not the flag, it is the spirit of the soldier. We are wishing he can find a way to find a family in Japan.
Keiko and her husband, Rex Zeke, run a nonprofit called the Obon Society. In Japan, Obon is a festival honoring the spirits of ancestors. They've turned their attic into a makeshift war flag research center.
When we started out, we thought we were just helping Japanese families receive heirlooms. Then, as this progressed, we realized we were connecting these families.
Lots of personal message and many signatures.
Keiko's own grandfather died fighting in the Pacific, but his grave is empty.
No bone, no remaining item, nothing came back.
But one day, his flag did.
We all thought that the spirit of the grandfather finally wanted to come home to see us.
It had such a profound effect. They wanted to see if they could identify more soldiers' flags and send them back to Japan. Once word got out, they were stunned. Flags from veterans or their families started arriving almost weekly.
Sometimes they include photographs of their father as a soldier or family pictures of themselves now. It's just this, it is this connection of this family to this family that were brought together through war.
So far, they've reunited about 60 flags with Japanese families and have more than 100 they're still researching, all at their own expense.
I mean, you guys have essentially spent your life savings to do this.
But it's just very important things to do.
Terry Stockdale waited and hoped. And then came word that the Obon Society had traced his flag back to a man named Yosugushu Kishi, a young soldier who kissed his wife, his 7-month-old son, and his 2-year-old daughter goodbye, and never saw them again. Those children, Masaru, now 73, and his sister, Kayoko, 75, both live outside Osaka. They knew little of their father until one day last December, the phone rang.
When I got the call, I thought this was impossible. My mind just went blank. After 70 years, I never dreamed something of my father's would surface.
They found out Terry not only had their father's flag, but he wanted to come to Japan to to deliver it himself. Anxious, they met Terry at the train station. What happened next says it all.
I mean, yeah, that's just beyond comprehension what it meant to them. It's just kind of, you know, it just wasn't some souvenir. It was actually their father coming home.
Terry officially handed it over at a formal ceremony and then stepped back to watch two people who never knew their father unfurl his flag together.
We don't know the warmth of his hands, the sound of his voice. I can't remember a thing about my father. And I said, I'm sorry, Dad, to that flag. I'm so sorry.
Now, where Mr. Kishi prays, sits a framed photo of Terry, a captured moment, a generation in the making.
You know, the old saying, it's better to give than receive. It just feels so good to do something for somebody.
As for his own father, well, Terry hopes that Staff Sergeant Glenn Stockdale is also finally at peace.
He'd be proud of me. He would know it's the right thing to do.
So that's just a nutshell of what it is that we do, and the people we serve on actually now both sides of the ocean. That was quite a surprise to us, and it's just a simple connection of family to family, and it's just about peace and reconciliation. We are now. People are communicating with us from all different levels, from brigadier generals to the veterans to all sorts. And what we will be sponsoring out in Portland, Oregon, this December 7th, is a Pearl Harbor remembrance. This is the 75th anniversary of Pearl Harbor. And we are going to do something a little more sweeping, perhaps, than what has been done in other remembrances, and that is we are going to, of course, start with Pearl Harbor, and we have a Pearl Harbor survivor who actually was in a 32-foot open boat in the middle of the harbor, ferrying people across the harbor when the planes came over. I mean, he is at ground zero, and so he saw it all from there and is decorated for saving soldiers that were sailors that were in the oil, and he has more letters from presidents than anybody you've ever seen, and he'll start out the talk. Actually, we'll have Admiral Nimitz's grandson be the opening person, and then this Pearl Harbor survivor, and then we're going to look not just at Pearl Harbor, but at the Pearl Harbor, the war, and then the following years up to the present to show this really unique story of these two countries who went to war, fought each other savagely, and then ended the war, made peace, and today, as Wes pointed out, are like among our most trusted friends and our greatest trading partners in exchange of the technology and science and research and medicine. The multiple relationships between America and Japan are something that the veterans that we talk to, who remember back to the era of war, thought that would never, ever, ever be possible, that you'd ever have any relationship, peaceful relationship with those people. But here is this example of it happening. So we are the Obon Society. You see what we've done. And are there any questions of any sort out there if people would like to talk to us? Yes, sir.